This is a lovely old Volvo, but even driving it that short distance into the workshop, I was very aware of the rough running that Mike was talking about. The engine seems to be popping and spitting, and the throttle response isn't that great either. So, to diagnose this problem, the first thing I'm going to do is do a compression test on that lovely little four-cylinder engine.
A compression test is something you can do at home. It will help you diagnose whether your engine has valve damage, excessive carbon buildup, or piston ring problems. It's the first stop to testing how fit the inside of your engine really is.
Now, I've removed all four spark plugs from the cylinder head, and the idea now, of course, is to put in the pressure gauge into each of the cylinders in turn, but by taking all the plugs out, when you turn the engine over, it's going to spin over a lot faster, and you're going to get a more accurate reading.
There's an ideal compression reading for each cylinder. It's different for every car, and your owner's manual will tell you what's right for yours.
OK, that should be enough there. Now, I'm expecting a compression of between maybe 170 to 200 for this car, and that looks like, well, I guess, about 185, which is actually I'm more than happy with. So one down, three to go. Now, I think we may have found a culprit for our rough running already. It's a bit odd that it's just one cylinder, but essentially, number one is showing 100 psi of compression, whereas the other three are showing 185. So clearly there's something wrong with that. Now, there's a number of things it could be, but I think the most likely thing is that there's some valve damage. This engine was designed to run on only leaded fuel. Now, it hasn't really been available for the last 10 years or so. And although you can get additives, if it hasn't been used on a couple of occasions, the valves run a bit hotter, they get a bit more pounding, and eventually they can get damaged. And I think that is what has happened to our engine. I think what I need to do is a little test. I'm suspecting that number one is at fault. What I need to do is just put the spark plugs back in, fill each chamber up with fuel, and then just let it stand for a while. If the fuel leaks out, then we know for sure there's problems with the valve seat. It would seem I was on the right track. The three cylinders that had good compression, there's no fuel that's actually run down the back of the valves, which is great. The one I did have my doubts about, number one, you can see the fuel has actually leaked past the seal of the valves, which means there is something wrong probably with the valve seat there. Now, I can't just get the one repaired. I need to do the whole head, and it's not something I can do myself. What's going to happen is I'll send it away, and they're going to replace the kind of dodgy valve seats, if you like, with hardened valve seats, and that means this car will then run on unleaded fuel. Now, it's going to take about a week, but I have got plenty to be getting on with our P1800. Our cylinder head is back from the machine shop. Now, we did have a problem before with one of the cylinders being down on compression, and it turns out that was because of a damaged valve seat. What I've got them to do is actually replace all of the valve seats with hardened ones, which now means, of course, our problem is solved, but also our engine is going to run on unleaded fuel, which is a real big bonus. Now, unfortunately, you can't see any of their magical workmanship because it's all hidden under these nice, clean valves. But rest assured, it is top-quality work. Now, I can't really put this head onto the engine until I've done a bit of prep work, so that's my next job. Well, the new head gasket is in position, the head is in place. I've now nipped up all of the head bolts. What I need to do now is torque them down to make sure that the head is actually attached to the block at the right pressure. And of course, as always, what I'm going to do is start at the middle and work my way in a kind of spiral action to the outside to make sure that that pressure holding it all down is even. And of course, it doesn't matter quite so much on a cast iron head as opposed to an aluminium head, but still, it makes sense to just do it with best practice in mind.
Remember those push rods I so carefully stored in order? Well, they're next to go in. Before I can go any further, I've got to adjust the tappet. This means setting the clearances between the rocker and the top of the valve. I'm using a feeler gauge for this, a small shim of metal of an exact thickness. I'm taking the clearance measurements from a Volvo workshop manual. If I don't set the gap properly, then the engine runs rough and I will damage the new valves. So this is an important job to get right, and I'm checking and checking again. The old rocker cover was a bit past it, so I bought a nice black one online, and it does give the engine bay a smarter look. All this reassembly work actually took 2 hours, but if it's your first try at something like this, I'd budget for double or treble that amount of time.
Everything's bolted back onto the engine of our P1800, so now what I need to do is actually top up the coolant system.
Coolant first. Water second. Then we're ready to run.
OK, the reworked head is in position, and this will be the first turn of the key on a new era of unleaded fuel for our Volvo. So here goes. Now, when I turn it over, it's going to be a flood of unleaded fuel into those carburetors. And doesn't it sound... Well, actually, it sounds really rubbish. That sounds really lumpy. And it's not supposed to sound like this. Essentially, I've just spent hundreds of pounds sorting out the head, and yet still, it sounds really, really nasty. I'm gutted. I need to find an answer to this rough-running engine, and fast. Our engine really should be running sweetly, so this is a properly annoying problem, but I do think I may have found the culprit. I've changed the spark plugs, I've changed the points, I've checked the ignition timing, I've checked, again, the valve timing. I've also checked for air leaks and stuff in the induction system. And it does seem, I think, really, there's something wrong with these carburetors. So I've got myself a rebuild kit. I'm going to take them apart, give them a good clean, and hope, fingers crossed, that's going to solve our problem.
Stripping down and rebuilding the carbs involves a lot of fiddly work. You can tackle this at home, but my advice is to take a lot of digital photos as a memory aid.
Now, if you think about how a carburetor actually works, when you put your foot on the throttle, you open this butterfly valve down here. That means air rushes into the engine, but that rushing of air actually forces this little piston away from this side of the carburetor. So, of course, the more air you're getting, the further away this is. Now, the action that's going on there is that actually this little needle is sliding in and out of this fuel delivery tube. So what happens is, as you accelerate, this piston kind of pulls away from this here, and then all that fuel that's coming here actually flows into the engine. And of course, the further away it goes, the more fuel you get. So what I'm going to do is replace all of those little parts that I can from my little kit, and then hopefully that should solve that problem, if it was a problem.
The kit of gaskets, pins and other oddities cost £68, and it's quite a complex job to do, but the results should transform our rough-running engine.
Right, with that side done, I now have to do the other carburetor.
Our car runs with twin carburetors, but some later P1800s had modern fuel injection systems. You can retrofit these to earlier cars, but to make the best money for our car, we've decided to keep everything as original as possible.
I'm a little bit nervous, especially after all of that work, but I'm now going to turn the engine over once more and hope that she's going to run sweet and smooth. What a relief, and what a great engine sound. That really is the sound of the swinging 60s.
Click here to subscribe.